So having seen the potential origins of all the bits and pieces for a self-replicating cell, we've got life. And what do we know about early life? Whatever the sequence of events, how accurate those guesses are about the micelles being the prototypes for the first cell walls or whatever, we know that life appeared on this planet about 3.8 to 3.5 billion years ago, and they were the bacteria. And the bacteria have proliferated, they've been on the Earth ever since then, and there are vast numbers of bacteria. They're in two large groups, the ones that we refer to by the common name of bacteria, and then there are these others called archaea. But these are also single-celled, and they are a form of bacteria, but genetically they're very distinct from each other. And it's important to talk about these because near here, where these would have diverged, this would reflect the circumstances of the earliest life on Earth. And so the modern bacteria that are closest to this root, in fact, occupy the kind of extreme habitats that we reckon characterized early Earth, with all of that volcanic activity and all of those geysers and everything everywhere. So archaea today thrive in extreme habitats, and habitats that are most similar to those early volcanic vents. This is an aerial photograph of a hot spring in Yellowstone National Park where the water is boiling hot, yet the coloration there is because there are bacteria that can thrive in that very hot environment. Some of these volcanic areas have got incredibly hostile environments, and yet there are bacteria that love it. They eat sulfur. They like the very acidic water that's there. And the way they actually metabolize, the way they get their energy to run their cellular processes is from the heat, the actual heat of the hot springs and the volcanoes themselves. Now, in the oceans, there are thermal vents that are 350 degrees Celsius, enormously hot. The oceans formed 4.5 billion years ago. There would have been thermal vents before anything could have grown probably up on the surface of the Earth, so there could have been a lot of life forming down around these thermal vents. And they are still there today, and there are bacteria that are very specialized for that. One of the smallest bacteria here, it's got a hard-to-pronounce name, Nanoarchaeum, and it thrives in these circumstances of 350 degrees Celsius. It would cook us, but they love it. So the present-day archaea occupy very harsh environments, and what's common about these is there's almost no oxygen in the places that archaea are really happiest. So like Giardia, that's a bacteria, and it causes us terrible intestinal upsets. And one of the reasons it does such nasty things to us is it really likes being in our gut where there's no oxygen. And there's another bacteria called Polaromonas, however you pronounce that, which eats mothballs, naphthalene or mothballs. It's a terrific diet for these things. They love these extreme environments. And there's Halomonas that lives on salt. So very different kind of metabolic rates and activities than we're used to in our world that we can see that's so comfortable for us. Now these earliest archaebacteria, dating back to about 3.8 billion years ago, they're called thermophiles because they loved heat, and they were also anaerobic. They didn't like oxygen. You expose them to the open air and they don't do well at all. So those are those that we've seen already. And then something happened at 2.2 billion years ago. A huge transformation that changed the surface of the Earth forever, and that's the origins of the cyanobacteria. The cyanobacteria have got a new way of living that doesn't thrive on heat, it thrives on sunshine. And once we have the Eubacteria, we have a very different planet, we have a whole lot more proliferation of different kinds of life. Now, what is the secret of the cyanobacteria? It's that they're capable of photosynthesis. These are the originators of a process that takes CO2 and water, you add a bit of sunshine, and you get sugar. And that's now a new form of metabolic energy, but it gives off oxygen. It gives off oxygen that could get into the atmosphere. So with photosynthesis, cyanobacteria could live wherever there was sunshine, so they could live throughout the whole ocean. So they didn't have to stay stuck next to those thermal vents. That's a lot of places, so they would have been enormously common all over the Earth's surface. But with photosynthesis, they're now producing oxygen all the time, and that changed the Earth's atmosphere forever. If we look back, it's possible to estimate what the composition of the atmosphere was through the earliest phases of the Earth. And it's only at about 2.2 billion years ago, with the advent of the cyanobacteria, that the amount of oxygen increased 10, 100, 1,000 fold, far more oxygen than there had been before. Now, this oxygen changed the chemistry of the planet. Oxygen levels in the ocean increased until iron compounds that were just dissolved in the ocean were perfectly happy in water. Now they're exposed to oxygen and they fell out as a form of rust. And that rust out of the ocean is now seen as the iron formation deposits. And these all date from about the same time, about 2 billion years ago. And we see this up on Lake Superior. There are many deposits of iron up there. That's the Iron Range, very old rock formations. So we have these 2 billion-year-old rock formations. Oxygen had this characteristic of binding with iron to rust. That's the same as burning if you have organic molecules that are suddenly exposed to a lot of oxygen. And so direct exposure to oxygen also breaks down most organic compounds. Our primordial soup, manufactured by a planetary Miller apparatus for hundreds of millions of years, didn't have to deal with oxygen. So all those compounds could be in the open atmosphere with no real problem. But once the oxygen is common, they start to deteriorate. They go stale. They don't work anymore. And so that destroyed the very conditions that allowed life to evolve in the first place.